Wonderful, wonderful song. Uniforms, which we all know about, are clothing worn by certain members of a society in a way to identify them and also to identify what they do, what acts they perform. For example, we know those who are soldiers and police officers, mailmen, nurses, professional athletes, just to name a few, because they wear distinctive outfits that classify them and the work that they perform. Well, the Bible teaches that we as Christians also wear a very distinct uniform. You may not know that, but it's true, in that we wear certain clothing that identifies who we are and what we do. Now, I'm not referring to physical clothing. I'm not referring to material clothing, but rather to spiritual clothing, what Paul refers to as the new man. Something, he says, we put on, like we put on clothing. Where does he say that? I'd like you to turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, and I want to read to you verses 20 through 24. Paul says, but you did not learn Christ in this way, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. Now, notice that in verse 22, Paul refers to our former manner of life, meaning the way we used to live before we became Christians. He calls it the old self. Some versions may say the old man, but the thought is the old self. And he speaks of it as something that we are to lay aside. And in verse 24, he refers to the new self, sometimes also translated the new man, as something that we are to put on. And by using these terms, laying aside the old and putting on the new, the apostle is using terms often found in ancient Greek literature of stripping off old clothing and putting on new clothing. That's the imagery. And although in our English translations, it may look as if Paul is commanding us to lay aside the old self and commanding us to put on the new self, as if this is something that we are being told to do right now, that's not at all what the apostle is teaching. And it's important that you understand this. See, what Paul is actually saying is that this has already happened. This has taken place. It's already taken place at a point in time in the past. We've already taken off the old self. We've already put on the new self. It happened at the moment of our conversion. Whether you recognized it or not, that's what happened. And there are two ways we know that this is precisely what Paul means. First of all, we know this because Paul clearly teaches in a parallel passage in Colossians chapter 3, using the same language, putting off and putting on. He speaks very clearly there without any question that it's something that's already happened. In Colossians 3, verses 9 and 10, parallel passage, same thoughts. Do not lie, he says to one another, since you, notice this, you laid aside the old self with its evil practices, it's already happened, and have put on the new self, who's being renewed to a true knowledge according to the image of the one who created him. So here in these verses, there is no question that Paul is saying that we already exchanged uniforms, the old self for the new self. It's the same thought, it's the same concept, very similar wording to what he says in Ephesians 4. You laid aside, he said, the old self, you have already put on the new self. This has happened already at a point in time in our past, that point being our conversion. That's number one. That's the first way we know that what Paul is saying in Ephesians 4 is not a command. He's saying it's already happened. Secondly, we know that Paul couldn't possibly be commanding us now in Ephesians 4 to lay aside our old manner of life and put on a completely new manner of life. We know it because if that were to be the case, then what he says next in Ephesians 4 would not make any sense. You see, if you notice in verse 25, Paul says, therefore, laying aside falsehood. But whenever you see the word therefore in Scripture, it always builds upon what has been previously written, something that is factual. That's why there's a therefore, based on this fact or this truth. But you can't base a command on another command, only a fact. So it wouldn't make any sense for Paul to be commanding us to lay aside our old self and then command us again to therefore lay aside falsehood. That's not logical. That's not reasonable. Nobody does that. So let me put all of this together for you. What these verses are saying is that the moment of our salvation, we exchanged our old set of clothes for a new set of clothes. This is just a very graphic, picturesque way of saying that at conversion, we made a complete break with our past lives. See, the term old self refers to all that we were in Adam before our salvation, essentially meaning our old sinful nature. When you see old self, it's really synonymous with the old nature, the old sinful nature. It was removed and it was taken off at salvation. And in its place, we put on what Paul refers to as the new man or the new self, meaning all that we are in Jesus Christ, our new regenerated nature. So at salvation, we took off the old sinful nature and we put on the new divine regenerated nature. Now, I've spent some time explaining this just to make the point that as Christians, we do wear a distinct uniform. The uniform of the new man that identifies who we are. We're Christians. And what we do, we conduct ourselves like Christians. We conduct ourselves like new men and women in Christ. See, these verses in Ephesians 4 are part of, as you know if you've been here studying with us, they're part of a larger section of Paul's teaching in this chapter, in which he explains that we have been given a new life in Jesus Christ. And that new life demands that we walk in a way that reflects that new life. We walk in a new way, meaning that we now behave in a way that is radically different from the way we used to behave as non-Christians. So what Paul does is, beginning with verse 17, he simply gives us several truths about this new walk in Christ. Now, in previous studies, we've already looked at two of these truths about our new walk. A few weeks ago, we looked at what I like to call the problem with our new walk. In verse 17, we read, "So this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk." Now, the new walk itself is not a problem. I use that terminology. The problem is not with the new walk. The problem is that our new walk is to take place amongst people who still are unconverted, and that's a challenge. This is often a great struggle because we are constantly battling our flesh and battling the world and battling the devil. And Paul says in verse 17 that you are not to walk the way that the Gentiles walk, meaning the pagans. You are not to walk the way you used to walk. And so there is some tension there. We live in a very sinful world, and it's not that easy, as you know, to live a godly life in an ungodly environment. However, this ought to be very encouraging to us because it tells us that if God has commanded us to not walk like we used to walk, then we can be certain that he will give us the grace and the strength to do exactly what he tells us to do, no matter how sinful, no matter how rough our environment might be, whether it be at home or at work or amongst colleagues or friends or in just your neighborhood. Whatever it is, God gives you the grace. If he commands you not to walk as others walk, he will give you the grace and the strength to do just that. So that's the first truth Paul told us about the new walk, and that there's a problem because it's not that easy. The second truth about the new walk that Paul teaches us is that once there was a past walk that all of us had, meaning that prior to our salvation, we all thought a certain way. We lived like the people Paul was referring to in verse 17, as the Gentiles also walk. And then Paul describes how the Gentiles walk. And by Gentiles, he means pagan, unsaved, unregenerate man. And that was all of us. So he says, in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them, because of the hardness of their heart, And they, having become callous, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. Now, this is the way, Paul says, that unregenerate men and women still walk, and the way that we used to walk. It's a life of darkness. It's a life of ignorance. It's a life of being alienated from God. It's a life of being callous to godly standards, which leads to all kinds of sensual and impure behavior. But the root issue of all of this is that, as Paul puts it, they walk in the futility of their mind. What he means by this, and we covered this last week, but I remind you, what he's talking about when he says futile is that of being aimless, pointless, going round and round without any direction. Nothing ever comes of this thinking that's of any value. In other words, unsaved man is looking for meaning in life. He's looking for purpose in life, but he'll never find it. Not with his thought process, because his thinking is aimless. Therefore, it will never lead him to where he needs to be led. It will never lead him to the truth of God, where he will find new life in Christ. Now, folks, this is where we left off last week. Having looked then at the problem of our new walk, having looked then at the past walk we all once had, Paul moves on now to tell us a third truth about our new walk, which is that our new walk, it's now. We have a present walk. It's now. It's not in the future. It's now. Our present walk. Verses 20 through 22. But you did not learn Christ in this way. If indeed you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus. With these words, the apostle makes a stark and really a rather dramatic contrast between the way we once were and the way we are right now. And you can see this by the words he starts off with. But you, in other words, you once were like Gentile pagans, walking in the futility of your mind, but that's all in the past. But you, here's the way they are, but you. And what Paul means by this is that, but you are now different. You don't walk that way anymore. You don't walk the way you once walked. You don't walk in darkness. You don't walk in ignorance. You don't walk in the futility of your mind. Something has happened to you that has changed you. Here's the way you were, but you are different now. He proceeds to tell them exactly what happened to them and how they changed. And here's what's fascinating. He uses three words, with each word having to do with thinking or learning, or you could even say schooling or education. And I take it that the reason Paul does this is because he's just taught on how the pagans think. They think in the futility of their minds, but now he tells us how we as believers think in order to explain our new and our present walk in Christ. First word that Paul uses that has to do with our thinking is the word learn. Notice again, verse 20. But you did not learn Christ in this way. Now, what Paul is referring to here when he speaks of learning Christ is our salvation. But that's an unusual way to speak of our salvation. It's an unusual way to speak of coming to faith in Christ. Normally, we don't say that we have learned a person. We say that we have learned about a person. We don't say we've learned a person, but that's exactly what Paul says. He says that we have learned Christ, not just about him, we've learned him. What he means by this is that we have come to not simply know about Christ, we have come to a personal relationship with him. We've learned him in the sense that we now know him. We don't simply know about him, although that's true. We know him. We've learned him. It's really what Jesus said in his high priestly prayer in John 17:3. He said, "This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ who you have sent." To have eternal life is to know God the Father in a personal way. It is to know Jesus Christ in a personal way. Look again, though, at verse 20 and see all that Paul said about learning Christ. He said, "But you did not learn Christ in this way." So, in what way is this way? What's he talking about? It's the way of walking as pagan Gentiles walk. The old walk of the way we used to think and behave. In other words, what Paul is saying is that when you met Jesus, when you learned him, When you were saved, you did not learn to walk as a pagan and to continue your old way of life. In learning him, you learned a totally new way of life, completely different from the old way of life. You didn't learn Christ like that. You learned something else. Listen, what Paul is saying is that to come to Christ is to break away from your old way of life. That's part of the gospel. That's Christianity. That's Christ. This is why the Bible teaches that true saving faith always involves repentance. It's a turning away from sin. Yes, it involves a change of mind, but it isn't simply a mental change of mind that doesn't affect your behavior. It's a turning from sin. Jesus preached repentance. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. John the Baptist preached repentance. He said the same thing. Paul preached repentance. In fact, all of the New Testament writers preached repentance, because no one can be saved if they are still holding on to their old way of life, refusing to let go of their sins. Why would you want a savior from sin if you wanted to continue in your sin? It doesn't even make sense. This is why when we witness, we are to speak of Jesus not simply as savior, but as Lord. Because to learn Christ is to learn to turn from the unrighteous way that people are living, and to turn to Christ in absolute surrender to his lordship, which involves a desire to live righteously. It's not Christianity if you're not proclaiming that. And a person who says, yes, I've come to learn Christ, but continues in the old way of life without any concern to repent and confess their sin, that person's not converted. We are all, as we witness, we are all to tell others about Christ. But you have to think about this. What kind of Christ are people learning from you? When you speak to them about the Lord, is it a Christ who makes no demands on living? That's not the Christ of the Bible. Is it a Christ who is lenient and tolerant of sin and says, live any way you want? That's not the Christ of the Bible. John Stott put it so well when he said, just as evangelists preach Christ, so their hearers learn Christ and receive him. But what sort of Christ do they learn? Not just the Word made flesh, the unique God-man who died, rose, and reigns. More than that, he said, the implication of the context is that we must also preach his lordship, the kingdom or rule of righteousness he ushered in, and all the moral demands of the new life. The Christ whom the Ephesians had learned was calling them to standards and values totally at variance with their former pagan life. And folks, you, in learning Christ, you've also been called to standards and values that are totally different from the ones you used to love and the ones you used to follow. But who called us to this new way of life? How do we know such things? How would we even know this, that the coming to Christ demands that we walk in a different manner? Well, notice the second word that Paul uses to speak of the change that has happened to us. The first is the word learn. We learned Christ. But the second, found in verse 21, is the word heard. We learn because we heard about this. Verse 21 at the beginning says, if indeed you have heard him. Now, Paul says that these Ephesian believers learned Christ by hearing him. Now, what does he mean by this? Because he certainly can't mean that the Ephesian believers heard Christ's physical voice during his earthly ministry. And we do believe that the letter to the Ephesians probably embraced other people in that area, not just the church at Ephesus, but how would these people have possibly heard Christ's physical voice during his earthly ministry, since these people lived in Asia Minor, and during his earthly ministry, Jesus never traveled outside of the land of Israel? So, what Paul must be saying is that they heard Jesus through the voice of Christian preachers and teachers who told them about him. In other words, they heard Christ speak to their hearts through the preaching of the scriptures as he called them to salvation. The Bible often refers to hearing Christ when referring to hearing his call to come to him. For example, in John 8:47, Jesus said, "He who is of God hears the words of God. For this reason, you do not hear them, because you are not of God." It's really what the song we just sang was talking about. We are listening to your word. We hear him. In John chapter 10, Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and they follow me." I've never heard his physical, literal voice, but we all have heard his voice if you've come to him through the scriptures. Hebrews 3, 7 and 8 say, "Therefore, just as the Holy Spirit says today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as when they provoked me, as in the day of trial in the wilderness." So in telling us that we have heard Jesus as he spoke to our hearts through those who told us the scriptures about salvation, him, Paul is saying that when we heard Christ, we heard him calling us. Not only did he call us, though, to himself for salvation, though that's true, but he called us to a completely new way of life. We heard him. We heard him. See, the gospel according to Christ is a message not simply to believe in him. It's a message to believe in him and to walk in a manner worthy of him. It's a message about following him. Jesus didn't call people simply to believe in him. He called people to follow him. Come, follow me. Not just believe in me, follow me. It's a message about dying to ourselves. It's a message about taking up the cross and coming to him. It's a message about putting away instruments of unrighteousness and having instruments of righteousness, as Paul teaches in Romans chapter 6. Listen again to John 10, 27. "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." They follow me. This is what we heard when we heard his voice through the scriptures. He called us to follow him, which means that we stop following our old way of life and we start obeying him. Folks, that's just New Testament Christianity. But that's not all. There is a third word that Paul uses in Ephesians 4 to explain the change that has taken place in us so that we no longer walk as the pagans walk or the way we used to walk. Notice, the first word is learn. We learn Christ. We didn't just learn about him, we learned him. We met him. We have a relationship with him. There's an intimacy there. Secondly, we heard him because we learned him by hearing him. How else would we learn? Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. We heard him. He spoke to our hearts. And now Paul uses a third word as he completes verse 21, which is the word taught. Notice verse 21 again. "If indeed you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus." Now, once again, this is stated in language that we don't normally use. We don't speak like this. Normally, we would say, "You have been taught by him," or "You have been taught about him." But that's not what Paul says. He says, "You have been taught in him." You notice that? Not about him, not by him, in him. We don't usually speak like that. So what does the apostle mean by this? Well, he means that when we experience salvation, we entered into a vital union with Christ himself, whereby, as he says in his word, he's in us and we're in him. So to have been taught in him is to have been taught in the sphere, in the realm, in the atmosphere of being in Christ. In other words, it's as if Paul is saying that Jesus isn't only the teacher, he's not only the subject of what is being taught, he's also the school where we learn. He's the very environment we learn, because it's in him, it's in this vital union in him that we were taught about him and this new life that he gives us. And the reason for this, Paul adds at the end of verse 21, notice, he says, is because just as truth is in Jesus, we've been taught in him, truth is in him. And the truth that Paul is talking about is simply the truth of our salvation and the great change and transformation of character, everything that that goes into salvation. All of this new way of living, this new walk that's so different from our old pagan walk, is found in the truth about Jesus. And what specifically is that truth? It's what Paul is going to tell us in verses 22 and through 24, that in coming to Christ, we laid aside our old self and we put on a new self. That's what we learned. That's what we heard. That's the school that we're in. All of this, this new life is present because we have laid aside that old life. We've put on a new life. And we're going to look, when we meet again, we're going to look more closely at these verses and see exactly what Paul has for us and what these verses are teaching. But for right now, you need to ask yourself, if you have learned Christ, if you have ever been taught by him, by hearing his voice in the scriptures, and that's not a mysterious or mystical thing. It's just as the word has dealt with you. You've been convicted of your sin. You see the truth about Christ. You come to him. If you have, then you have laid aside the old self. You have put on the new self. That's already taken place. That's why the scripture says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. It's already happened. And that means that you're ready. You're willing to walk this new walk. You're ready to live this kind of new life. And that's why Paul, starting in verse 25, will go on to say, but there are certain areas in our lives that we now do have to put off. We put off the old man. We put off the old nature. But we still struggle in areas. And that's why, if you look at verse 25, he'll talk about truth, laying aside falsehood. Speak truth. You have laid aside the old nature. So now, make sure that the way you speak is truth, not falsehood. He'll go on, for example, in verse 28, he who steals must steal no longer. So he must labor, performing with his own hands what is good. So put off stealing, put on generosity. But you can only do that because you already have put off your old self. These are just areas. These are just application points. Notice again, verse 29, let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth. Now, all of us struggle with speech and speaking to people. We all at times have unwholesome words. Paul says, put that off. But you can only put that off because you've already put off the old self. The old nature is gone. You've had a new nature. You still struggle with sin, but it's not because of a nature. So we put off the way of speech that's unwholesome. But notice he says, but only such a word as is good for edification. We put on that. Notice again, verse 31, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Put that off. You can do that if you put off the old nature. And what do we put on? Verse 32, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has also forgiven you. You put on that kindness. You put on that act of forgiveness. All of this, though, is predicated on the fact that you have laid aside the old nature at salvation, and you've put on a new nature. This is God's work in our hearts. So if that's taken place, you are ready. You can live godly right now. But if this just sounds so foreign to you, if you've not learned Christ, if you've not been taught by him, hearing his voice in the scriptures, if you've not laid aside the old nature and received a new nature, then you need to repent of your sin. You need to learn Christ. You need to meet him. You need to turn to him as not only Savior, but as Lord. That's who he is. And begin not only salvation, but begin to live in a way that reflects your salvation. Let's look to the Lord in prayer and ask yourself if there's any doubts you have. Is this true of you? Where do you stand? Where do you stand? Are you still living? You may be a new creation in Christ, but you're dabbling too much in the old way of life. Turn from that. Don't walk the way you used to walk. That's not biblical Christianity. That's not honoring to the Lord. That's not who you are. If you have... a new self, then live like that. If you put on new clothing, then live like that clothing. You've clothed yourself with Christ and live the way he wants you to live. But if there's no desire in your heart for that, then you need to still turn to Christ. You need to be saved. You need to come to know the Savior. I urge you to do that. Father, we thank you that these are profound truths, but this is biblical Christianity. And in some circles, Lord, we've deviated so far from these truths that we seem to want to tell people that they can accept Christ and then live like a pagan. Lord, that's so foreign to your word. I pray that you'll help us to understand, even as the song we sang, with new eyes, new insights to the word, that you would help us to know what it means to learn Christ, to be taught by him, to be schooled in him, and Lord, to live not in a legalistic way, but in a way that truly reflects genuine godliness in the way we speak, the way we treat others, our manner of kindness to people. I pray that all this would reflect you, Lord. We thank you that we have learned you. We thank you, Lord, that knowing you is not simply knowing about you, but knowing you as a person. And I pray that to every Christian here, you'll make yourself even more real than ever. And I pray for those who may not know you, that you'll show them that they don't know you, and that they'll turn to you to be saved, and that they'll really experience what it means to be born again and become a new creature in Christ. All of this we pray, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. We thank you for coming. Have a wonderful week, and you're dismissed.